I wanted to thank everybody so much for being here. Good afternoon, and welcome to our presentation. My name is Ruth Kruger, and I'm the Communication Strategist with the Ontario Neurodegenerative Disease Research Initiative, or ONDRI. ONDRI is a research initiative that's studying five different neurodegenerative diseases, Alzheimer's, including mild cognitive impairment, Parkinson's disease, ALS, FTD, and cerebrovascular disease, all with the aim of better understanding the similarities and the differences of these diseases in order to discover improved ways of diagnosing and treating them. But more on ONDRI is to come from Dr. Masellis, who will be presenting. There's many exciting things going on in ONDRI that we're very happy to share with you today. But first, I'd really like to thank Parkinson's Canada for co-hosting this webinar with us and making sure that this important information is delivered to our audience today. So thank you very much. Next, I'd like to just introduce all our presenters. I'll introduce everybody at once, and then as we flow through, I'll just quickly reintroduce each presenter. So first up is Dr. Mario Masellis. He's the consultant neurologist and director of the Movement Disorders Clinic in the Department of Medicine at Sunnybrook Health Science Centers. A clinician and scientist, Dr. Masellis is assistant professor of neurology in the Department of Medicine at the University of Toronto, as well as one of the three co-leads of ONDRI, along with Drs. Doug Munoz and Rick Schwartz. Dr. Masellis will be introducing us to ONDRI in a bit more detail and focusing on the Parkinson's cohort and then talking about some of the exciting research that is taking place. Next, we will have Laura Macalagan, who's a senior epidemiologist with the Institute for Clinical Evaluative Sciences, or ICES. Laura is one of the co-leads of ONDRI's AIM-4, which you'll be hearing more about, and she'll be talking about a publication that she is co-lead author on, which is focused on Parkinson's drugs. Following Laura, we'll be hearing from Sarah Robichaud, who's the founder and president of Dancing with Parkinson's, as well as a dedicated dance teacher in Toronto. Sarah will be telling you more about her program and some of the changes that have been implemented for COVID. And finally, we'll be hearing from Drs. Gros and Kalia. Dr. Priti Gros is co-chief resident in her last year of training in the adult neurology residency program at the University of Toronto. She's hoping to become a movement disorder neurologist and researcher in the future. And Dr. Lorraine Kalia is a neurologist at the Movement Disorders Center and co-director of Kalia Labs at Crimble Research Institute at Toronto Western Hospital at the University Health Network. She focuses on caring for people living with Parkinson's and discovering new treatments for the disease. She's also a member of the board of directors of Dancing with Parkinson's. Both doctors have been involved in important research through the Dancing with Parkinson's program in partnership with the OBI, the Ontario Brain Institute, and ONDRI. Dr. Gros will be presenting more on this study, and Dr. Kalia is available to answer any questions. Now for some quick housekeeping. This session is being recorded, and so will be available online following this session if you'd like to for some reason, see it again. And we've muted everyone's microphone, except for the speakers, to ensure that there's no unintended interruptions. If you have any questions, please type them into our chat box or reserve them to the end when we'll open up the floor to answer them. And now, with no further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Masellis.
Great. Thanks so much, Ruth, for the introduction. And thank you all for attending. I hope that this will be an interesting and informative day for you, and I hope we have an opportunity to answer some questions. So I'm going to be presenting a little bit about the Ontario Neurodegenerative Disease Research Initiative. The acronym is ONDRI. We'll be going through where we've been, where we're going, and implications for care of people living with Parkinson's disease. So on today's agenda, I'll go a little bit about the past, present, and the future. We'll highlight some unique ONDRI research implications for the Parkinson's community, and specifically Laura, Dr. Groh, and Dr. Kalia will be presenting on that, and then we'll illuminate some other Parkinson's disease initiatives which we've been involved in. ONDRI's mission is to catalyze advances in dementia and motor disorders, which are complex syndromes due to multiple neurodegenerative diseases, along with cerebrovascular disease, and with the goal of helping to improve the diagnosis, prognosis, care, and outcomes for persons living with these diseases and those who support them. When we talk about dementia, when we talk about Parkinsonism and as a manifestation of a neurodegenerative disease, We have to understand a little bit about what's happening in the brain in patients who suffer from neurodegenerative diseases. And one common feature is that there are proteins that exist within the brain that are normally help the brain function properly. They allow different cells to speak to each other and communicate to each other. And what happens in all neurodegenerative diseases, whether we're talking about Alzheimer's disease or Parkinson's disease, is that these proteins, which are able to be soluble in water that exists in brain cells, become insoluble. And when they become insoluble, the proteins start to clump together. And when they start to clump together, they start to damage the function of neurons, and eventually neurons die. And so when these proteins accumulate, and leading to neuronal death, you manifest with symptoms of a neurodegenerative disease. And so this slide is just showing what we see on a microscope after someone has passed away from these diseases that we think is probably one of the important contributing features that cause the symptoms. So in the top left, we see amyloid and tau changes in the brain, and this is very typical of what we see in Alzheimer's disease. In next to that, we see the alpha-synucleinopathies, and alpha-synuclein, when it accumulates in the brain, it forms it forms inclusions called Lewy bodies, and these impair neuronal function, and this is why you get manifestation of diseases like Parkinson's disease. But patients with Parkinson's disease can also manifest with cognitive impairment and dementia as the disease progresses. So the alpha-synucleinopathies are a group of disorders that are related to Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease is the most common form of alpha-synucleinopathy, but in fact, there are a group of disorders that occur along the spectrum. The tauopathies are another group of diseases that occur along the spectrum of what we call frontotemporal dementia, and the TDP-43 proteinopathies are another group of brain diseases that manifest either with frontotemporal dementia or Lou Gehrig's disease, motor neuron disease. And next slide. And we can't also forget how common stroke is in the brain, or small cerebral vascular disease. This is another pathology that can exist with any of the neurodegenerative pathologies, or it can exist on its own, that can also produce symptoms of memory and can also impair your gait. And so this is a type of pathology that leads to small vessel strokes in the brain. And the reason why I want to harp on this, and which is why ONDRI is such a unique study, is that if you're over the age of 65 or 70, and if you show signs of one of these neurodegenerative diseases, such as Alzheimer's or such as Parkinson's disease, then you're at higher risk of having not just the alpha-synuclein abnormality that we see in Parkinson's disease, but you may also have coexistent Alzheimer's changes in the brain. And that's why many patients with Parkinson's may be at risk of developing dementia, because of these coexistent changes. Also, many patients can also have small vessel disease in the brain. So one thing we're trying to do in ONDRI is to understand why, if you develop disease after the age of 65, why we see often these co-pathologies that can contribute to the neurodegenerative presentation. And I'm happy to answer questions about that. What we're trying to do in ONDRI is we want to advance basic science, individual and health system discoveries to benefit persons living with dementia and motor disorders such as Parkinson's disease. And so the first aim is focusing on a cohort that was studied as part of the first phase of ONDRI, which has now ended. And right now we're in the process of analyzing a lot of data from this. And so we're trying to learn and understand more about markers of the disease when someone's alive, and markers that can predict that someone has a pure pathology, such as pure Parkinson's changes in the brain, or whether they may have coexistent Alzheimer's or other pathologies that are contributing. The second aim of ONDRI is to use wearable devices such as sensors that can monitor for movement and for sleep in order to better understand and to be able to do measurements from patients who are suffering from Parkinson's and the other diseases I'm talking about in the home environment. So you don't need to necessarily come into the hospital laboratory for assessments. So there'll be some discussion about this as well. The third aim is that we have to acknowledge that in order to learn more about these neurodegenerative diseases, we cannot work in isolation. We have to collaborate with other groups who have also studied these diseases. And so it's only with putting all of our data together and analytical skills together and validating and replicating findings across all of these studies that exist worldwide, including ONDRI, will we be able to make more reliable discoveries that are valid. Because there's always a chance that when you get a result, there may be what's called a false positive result. And so we want to replicate these findings in collaboration with our other collaborative study groups. Finally, an important point that that Laura is going to be talking about is how can we link all of this information that we're gathering in ONDRI real time, how can we link it with real time measures such as hospitalizations when a patient is admitted to the hospital, and what drugs they're taking, and what maybe some of the outcomes of the drugs that we're taking. So I'll go through this in a little bit more detail. So the guiding principles of ONDRI is, first of all, we take a team science approach, knowing that working with many experts across many different areas of research will enhance our ability to find things and new discoveries. We take a cross-disease approach. So while we can look at each individual disease, such as Parkinson's disease, and compare it to Alzheimer's disease, we can also look at all of these diseases in the same way, because we plan to study them in the same way. So we can gather data and learn about these diseases, about people who may be at risk for developing dementia, who have Parkinson's disease, mainly because they might share a co-pathology such as Alzheimer's or strokes in the brain. We measure things precisely, and we have very rigorous quality control methods. So when we release our data to be used and to be studied, we're very certain that the data is accurate. And then finally, we want to integrate our research findings into care and practice through partnerships. And so we have a partnership, a patient and community advisory committee, which I'll mention a little bit later on. So ONDRI is funded by the Ontario Brain Institute, which is ultimately funded by the government of Ontario. And so ONDRI takes a broader scope of things. It doesn't only look at neurodegenerative diseases, but it looks at other brain diseases such as depression, cerebral palsy, epilepsy, neurodevelopmental disorders, and concussion. And this approach is important mainly because concussion and depression can be a risk factor or a harbinger for neurodegenerative diseases. So by studying all of these diseases under the umbrella of the Ontario Brain Institute, we can better understand more about some risk factors for neurodegenerative diseases by looking at data before someone develops them. In the first phase of ONDRI, we studied five diseases. So we studied cerebral vascular disease, and that is represented by the red blocks, frontotemporal dementia, which is a form of dementia that presents predominantly with behavioral symptoms or language deficits. We studied Parkinson's disease, both with and without cognitive impairment, and many patients in the study also had some degree of dementia. We studied patients with Alzheimer's disease and the prodrome for Alzheimer's disease, known as MCI or mild cognitive impairment. And we also studied patients with ALS or amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. This is a disease that produces weakness in the muscles as a result of motor neurons degenerating. This is the ONDRI Rubric's Cube. And so on the face of the cube, we had assessments done at baseline, but we also collected data over 3 years, actually mainly 2 years. So we have follow-up data in all of our participants, or in a large portion of our participants. They were studied with clinical measures, such as measurements of movement. They were studied with genomic methodologies. They were studied with detailed neuropsychology, which is the way we evaluate memory and thinking and cognition. They were studied very relevant to Parkinson's disease using a gait and balance platform to assess how people can walk and what troubles they're having. We look at eye movements, so abnormalities in eye movements can be an indicator of neural brain circuit dysfunction. We also looked at brain imaging using MRI, and we also looked at retinal imaging. The back of the retina is the window to the eye, and so by looking at the retina, we hope to get to insights, we hope to learn about brain function through the retina, which is a window to the brain. We were successful in recruiting 520 participants at baseline, including their study partners. We had excellent longitudinal retention over time. You can see that we included 160 patients with cerebral vascular disease, 53 with FTD, 140 with Parkinson's, 126 with Alzheimer's and mild cognitive impairment, and 40 with ALS. And you can see we had good retention over the 2 year study period. With respect to the Parkinson's disease cohort, we were able to follow up on 110 individuals who participated. So this is a real commitment to those Parkinson's patients and their caregivers who participated in the study. And we really thank them for their commitment to the study. So I'll just briefly touch on and give some examples of what we're trying to do in ONDRI. I went through this in detail, but what I'll do is I'll go into some more details, but we'll go through essentially the four aims of what we're hoping to achieve in the second phase of ONDRI. So with respect to aim one, we now have collected this wealth of data across all of these different diseases. And what we want to try to do is in addition to just studying one disease in isolation, we want to understand why some individuals who have a diagnosis of Parkinson's disease may also develop dementia while others do not, or while others, you know, don't show signs of dementia in Parkinson's disease. And so one way of studying this is to look at the different measures we've collected. In one of our studies that was recently published in the journal Movement Disorders, looked at a genetic finding. So they looked at mutations or abnormalities in the gene called NOTCH3. This is a gene involved in a form of small vessel disease. The name of the disease is called CADASIL. And when we see mutations in this gene, patients develop strokes and develop dementia more quickly. What we did was in our Parkinson's disease cohort, we found several patients, a small proportion of patients who had NOTCH3 mutations or abnormalities in this gene. And what we found is that these individuals with Parkinson's disease actually had more small strokes in the brain than those who did not have these mutations, indicating that there may be some shared risk, not only for Parkinson's disease, but also for this condition called CADASIL, which can lead to strokes and cognitive impairment. So that was one study that we looked at specifically relating to the synergy between small vessel disease of the brain and Parkinson's disease. We are scheduled to release our data more broadly to the larger research community. And the idea here is that we will be working on this data ourselves and are publishing lots of papers right now on this. But the idea is that other researchers may have ideas, and it would be of value for them to access this wealth of data whom the participants contributed to understand and learn more about these diseases. And we feel that this is an excellent way for us to move forward in the future, and that would most benefit the study participants and other patients suffering from Parkinson's and related neurodegenerative diseases. Next slide. In aim two, as I mentioned, we want to focus on remote and clinical monitoring using wearable devices such as watches that can measure movements and other measures. And so we want to focus on the remote and clinical monitoring to improve diagnosis, prognosis, care, and outcome for patients and those who support them. So we have two studies, one study that is complete and we're in the process of analyzing this data, which was essentially a study to see if we can bring these wearable devices into the homes of patients with these conditions and get them to hook up the devices properly so that we can collect data. And we achieved feasibility, and now we're in the process of analyzing the preliminary data to see how it correlates with all of these other measures that we were able to collect, such as brain imaging and such as cognitive and memory thinking tests. And we are now in the process of setting up a new study called Hands Ontario, which I'll go to on the next slide. So in this study, we hope to, it's called Health, Hands Ontario stands for Health in Aging and Neurodegenerative Diseases in Ontario. And so what we want to do is to facilitate care such as self-management, remote management in the community. We're going to collect blood samples from participants in order to look for blood-based biomarkers and also to do further genetic studies. We want to link this data with data that's collected as part of using the healthcare system in Ontario. And so this data can capture things like hospitalizations, how many times someone has been hospitalized. It can capture data on side effects of treatments, for example. So there's a whole host of linkages we can be made that can be made with the other data we're collecting. We want to be able to improve care for patients and also to predict outcomes such as falls. And so the idea here is that with this wearable technology, together with these blood-based biomarkers and also with some at-home cognitive assessments that can be administered at home, we want to collect data that can is leaner and meaner than the first wave of ONDRI, where patients committed to coming in for four full days of assessments. We want to be able to collect this data real time and in the home setting to get a better sense of how people are doing at home. Next slide. In the first phase, we're going to be looking at several studies, one of dementia in the nursing homes and community, another in ALS to detect swallowing difficulties. And in Parkinson's disease, we hope to be able to roll out the wearable devices so that patients with Parkinson's disease can self-monitor symptoms and so that they can we can collect real-time data about how they respond to a pill of levodopa, for example. And so in this study, the idea is we want to use these wearable biosensors to improve management and function, to explore detection of falls and other problems associated with this. And we have several sites involved. We'll let you know more about this as the study rolls out. In the third aim, I mentioned this before, but we cannot work in a silo. What we have to do is we have to work together with other groups who are studying these diseases in order for us to really make groundbreaking findings. And the reason for this is because ONDRI is a sample of very well-studied 520 individuals with the different neurodegenerative diseases, but there are many other studies out there that have looked at only Alzheimer's disease and many studies that have looked at only Parkinson's disease. And so we really need to combine our efforts to really figure these diseases out in order to be able to develop new treatments and understand more about what causes these diseases and how we can improve outcomes for patients. In aim four, we want to use these health services databases, and one is called the Institute for Clinical Evaluative Sciences, otherwise known as ICES, in order to describe health service utilization and outcomes of people with neurodegenerative diseases. So Laura and Dr. Susan Bronskill are working diligently on this topic to develop methods for identifying people with living with dementia and other neurodegenerative diseases such as Parkinson's disease, using this data that's collected as part of the healthcare system in our province. This will help us to enable practical and innovative clinical trials and also to inform clinical practice and healthcare policy. And Laura's going to be talking a little bit about some interesting studies that she's been doing on drug therapy in Parkinson's disease. Finally, I want to acknowledge the partnership with our patient community and advisory committee. They have been extremely helpful. They're represented not only by patients and caregivers, but by representative societies such as Parkinson Canada, who we're thankful is partnering with us in this talk and have allowed us to kind of reach out to all of you through their larger network, ALS Canada, the Heart and Stroke Foundation, the Alzheimer's Society of Ontario, as well as a group of primary care memory clinics, the Mint Memory Clinic group. We really want to, the PCAC has really helped us in co-designing research protocols, figuring out how to make our testing and our evaluations more relevant directly for patients. Or I think we should wait for the questions at the end of the talks, just because they may be tight on time. Thanks everyone for your attention.
Yes, thanks so much, Dr. Masellis, really appreciate it. So Laura Macalagan will be speaking next, and she'll be sharing her slides. So welcome, Laura.
And you should be able to see them now. Let's put them in full screen. Does that look good, Ruth?
Yep.
Perfect. Okay, so thanks for the kind introduction. As Ruth mentioned, I'm Laura Macalagan. I'm a senior epidemiologist at a health services research institute called ICES. And as Mario introduced, we're really a strong partner as part of the ONDRI portfolio, working on AIM4, which focuses on health services research. And I'll talk a little bit more about what that is. So for today's talk, I'm going to be focusing on a study that Mario alluded to, which really looked at identifying drugs that might have the potential to modify disease in Parkinson's disease. We used some interesting methods. We used a combination of what we'll call artificial intelligence methods, so sort of advanced computer methods, and pharmacoepidemiology. So that's basically a fancy word for looking at drug data in our health administrative data. And so to start off, I'll sort of explain what the purpose of the study was and what drug repurposing is and how can we help it? How can we help find new therapies for Parkinson's disease using this method? I'll talk a little bit about the health administrative data that we have access to at ICES and how that can help us answer real world questions regarding Parkinson's disease and many other diseases, including other neurodegenerative diseases that are part of the ONDRI work. We'll also dive a little bit deeper into some of the results and the conclusions of this study and some of the future work and implications that this might have for people living with Parkinson's. So, as a background, as you might be aware, there are very few drugs that can be used in Parkinson's disease currently, and really a lack of drugs that could be used to slow or modify the progression of Parkinson's disease and other neurodegenerative diseases. As you may or may not know, large studies called clinical trials are needed to develop new medications. And these studies and other basic science studies are really costly. And we've seen in the medical literature, and you may have heard in the news, that a lot of these recent studies have been unsuccessful, particularly in the area of Alzheimer's disease. Now, one of the ways that we can potentially combat this to try to find new effective therapies is by using something called drug repurposing. And drug repurposing is basically just using drugs that are already approved to treat certain diseases for a different disease. So an example might be that a medication that is used to treat high blood pressure could potentially be repurposed as an effective treatment or a preventative for Parkinson's disease. We'll talk a little bit more about that. Now, the first step in this process to identify which drugs can potentially be repurposed is to identify existing drugs in the literature that have the potential to help prevent or modify Parkinson's disease or another disease of interest. So in our particular study, we used an artificial intelligence algorithm or system, and we specifically used the IBM Watson computer system. And you might have heard of IBM Watson before. It basically is just a really, really advanced and really strong computer system that can help rapidly search the existing medical literature to help us identify drugs that have a high potential to be associated with preventing or modifying Parkinson's disease. Now, once IBM Watson or another artificial intelligence or computer system identifies these drugs, there's really a need to understand how does the drug actually affect people in a real world setting? So does it actually prevent or modify Parkinson's disease in large populations of patients? And to answer this question, we really look to the health administrative data that we are privileged to have access to at ICES. And I'll talk a little bit more about that. So the objective of this study really was to identify drugs that might prevent or slow Parkinson's disease. And I mentioned that we used a combination of approaches using advanced computer methods, using the IBM Watson system, and our real-world data or the health administrative data. Now, as Mario introduced us to, the goal of ONDRI Aim For is really to look at those health system records. So these are records that are collected whenever you interact with the health system. So these records are primarily collected for billing purposes, but they can be used in a secondary way for research purposes. And so these records will help us inform healthcare policy and planning for people living with neurodegenerative diseases like Parkinson's disease, as well as other diseases. So what we're really doing here is we're sort of widening the lens of looking at patients with Parkinson's and other diseases throughout Ontario. So sort of widening this lens beyond the 520 ONDRI cohort participants. So just to give you a background about who or what is ICS. So ICS is an independent, not-for-profit research institute, and we're primarily funded by the Ontario Ministry of Health and Long-Term Care, as well as other research funding from the Ontario Brain Institute, for instance, and other organizations. We really have a strong expertise in looking at health services research to understand how this can be used to help inform policymakers and stakeholders when they're making important healthcare decisions. And we do have a special status under Ontario's privacy legislation, and that really allows us to collect and store data, anonymized health data, for the purposes of healthcare research. So we're actually an Ontario-wide network, just to give you a little bit of a background. So we have sites across the province. I usually work out of the central site at Sunnybrook Hospital. I'm working from home at the moment. But we do have sites from across the province, and we have collaborators, over 400 collaborators from across Ontario. And what does the data that we have access to look like? So this data is really a vast array, so a really large repository of data that covers all of the Ontario population. So we have over 18 billion healthcare records, so that represents about 20 million Ontarians who've lived both past and present, over 500 billion data points, and this is growing rapidly. So in our big data repository, we have access to a variety of information that helps us understand how people interact with the healthcare system. So we have information on physician visits, for instance, when someone's hospitalized, when they enter a long-term care home, or whether they receive publicly funded home care services. We also have information on other healthcare services like prescription drugs for people over the age of 65. And we use that information in this particular study that I'll describe today. Other information that helps us understand the patient population includes information on their age, their sex, where they're living in the province, as well as their eligibility for health insurance. And we are able to assemble what we call cohorts. So these are groups of patients with specific diseases to understand how they experience the healthcare system. And what we do at ICS is we use what we call sort of an anonymous identifier, so an ID number for each patient that's been anonymized, and we're able to actually combine information from across these different databases to get a picture of the healthcare services and health of each Ontarian. So this slide here is an infographic that we developed for our current study. And this really summarizes some of the findings and the approaches that we took in the study. I'll go through each part of this in a little bit more detail now, but this is just to give you a bit of an overview. All right, so how did we design this study? Well, in the health administrative data, we developed what we call an algorithm or a rule to understand who has Parkinson's disease. And we were actually able to validate that, so that means test the rule against some clinical records. So we actually know that it has good predictive ability. So we're pretty sure that in fact these patients do have Parkinson's. So in the health administrative data, we were able to identify almost 15,000 individuals with Parkinson's disease over the age of 70. And we were actually able to match them to a control population of people who looked similar based on their age, sex, and comorbidity levels, but who actually didn't have Parkinson's disease. And what we were able to do was look back in time to look at the history of drug use for 15 drugs that were identified by that IBM Watson algorithm that might prevent or treat Parkinson's disease. And so we were able to look at this drug use prior to Parkinson's disease diagnosis to understand whether there were associations with someone being newly diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. And this slide really summarizes our results. It might look a little bit messy, but I'll break down the results for you here. So this slide shows what's called a forest plot. And a forest plot really helps us understand some statistical associations. So it helps us understand whether these particular drugs might be associated with preventing or increasing the risk of Parkinson's disease. So as I mentioned, in this particular study, we looked at 15 drugs that were actually approved for other uses. So these are medications that are approved for indications or uses such as high cholesterol or high blood pressure or infections. Some of them are antibiotics. So they're actually not approved for Parkinson's, but we wanted to understand, were they associated with Parkinson's disease? And what we found was actually some of them were. So we found that in the green, so you can see in the green squares, that 5 of the drugs were actually associated with a decreased risk of Parkinson's disease. So that means in our group of patients, taking these drugs was actually associated with a lower odds of developing Parkinson's disease. On the other hand, we actually found 2 drugs that were associated with an increased risk of Parkinson's disease. Now, one of them you might see has an estimate or a dot here that goes way out to the right side, and that's a drug called propranolol. And this finding was actually expected based on how we know this drug is used. So we know that this drug can be prescribed for tremor, which is often an early symptom of Parkinson's disease. So it was expected that we found this finding. And it's actually reassuring because we know our health data is working the way we would think it would work. So in conclusion, our results really showed that we had some expected relationships with some drugs that had already shown relationships in the medical literature. And these drugs were drugs that can be used for other indications, but might prevent or slow Parkinson's disease. We also found some new potential relationships. So some drugs called dexamethasone, pentoxifilin, and theophylline might be associated with preventing or slowing Parkinson's disease. Now, these results aren't conclusive at this time. So what we're showing here is just an association. In order to really understand whether these drugs could be repurposed for additional therapies for Parkinson's disease, really future work is needed in terms of clinical studies and laboratory studies to understand how these drugs might impact or slow or prevent Parkinson's disease. So I'd like to really acknowledge the support of our project team and our study team members listed here, and also the support of the ONDRI PCAC. So Mario had introduced them. So they really helped us to shape and understand and interpret some of the findings for this study. Thank you so much for your attention. I'd be really happy to answer any questions you might have later.
Thanks so much, Laura. Great presentation.
Thank you.
That was awesome. Okay, so moving on to Dancing with Parkinson's. So Ashley will be sharing a video with us to start off, and then Sarah Robichaud will be speaking to us a little bit. Thank you. Sarah.
Thank you. Thanks, Ruth. I just want to say thank you to ONDRI and Parkinson Canada for inviting me to speak today. I see so many faces of people that I used to dance with and people that I'm dancing with now and people that I really want to start dancing with us. I want to take a minute to tell you about this really fun thing that we're doing every single day. We're dancing together from this living room of mine and from wherever you are at. Prior to COVID-19, we did have 15 in-person locations running for people with Parkinson's disease in various locations in long-term care, seniors' residences, community halls, dance studios, you name it, we were there. And obviously, when the government mandated that we all go into isolation and physically distance, first of all, I thought, how are we going to stick to our mission of this in-person service of bringing persons with Parkinson's disease out of isolation and into an artistic community where they can connect with others? How do we do that when we can't leave our homes? And so I immediately was just like, I need to connect with the dancers. I need to connect with my dancers. And I wrote a thing on Facebook and I said, does anybody want to dance with me tomorrow on Zoom? And I think it was maybe the second time I'd ever used Zoom in my life at that point. And the dancers came. They came and they said, let's do this again tomorrow and the next day. And we've done over 200 classes on Zoom since then. We have not taken a day off. And it's been actually one of the funnest, most hopeful, most joyful experiences that we have had in the 13 years of delivering Dancing with Parkinson's. Dance has this ability to break down every barrier, age, race, religion, even technology. Somehow, through this fourth wall of technology, we are still able to connect with one another every single day. We're still able to stand by our mission of coming out of isolation, connecting with others, and exploring our own artistry. The thing that's beautiful about this class is that it's offered every single day, which means we can come and look forward to dancing with each other, but also we're getting a little bit of exercise every day. It's about 25 minutes long. We chat at the beginning, we chat at the end, we hear who's making what recipe, we're making friends from across the country. In this very challenging time, a time when it's, you know, it's hard to find things to keep us active, it's hard to find things to keep us connected. I challenge all of you to register with us. It's totally free, and to try us out and to see if you enjoy the movement, the music, and being with others who are really all experiencing very many of the same things. And I'm telling you, it's a transformational experience every day. And we are hearing this from our dancers, and again, I see many of you on there nodding your heads. It is a time where we feel uplifted. You know, the very basis of dance, we're working on our posture and our flexibility and our range of motion and our expression and all of these things that we all need as humans to be working on and to addressing in our daily physical activity. But then there's this other beautiful part where we're doing this together. There's a real sense of belonging. We just did a recent evaluation with the Complex Center for Health Interventions, where we surveyed 70 of our participants on the 200 classes that we've taken. And 80% of our dancers reported that they feel improved energy, that they 64% said they feel less isolated, that 60% of them are taking 4 to 7 classes a week. So can you imagine when you exercise and you do something once a week, how good you feel for that period of time and maybe a little bit after, to have something that's available to you right from either your bed, your chair, your walker, your wheelchair, wherever you want to be, 7 days a week. And so, you know what? I feel like I've talked a lot about it. And I think the best thing to do is maybe give you a chance to experience a little bit of movement. So we're going to dance together. So what I'm going to ask you to do is just make sure you're sitting on some kind of chair. I think we're all sitting, right? Nobody's watching the webinar standing. And I just want you to make sure that the space around your feet and the space around your mid-body and your upper body is clear. And the rest, we're just going to have fun. I want the music to come into your body. If you don't like what I'm doing, just do your own thing. But we're going to make a pizza together. All right? Thank you, Ashley. Anytime you're ready with the music.
A boy went back.
So I want you to grab some pizza dough.
He was in the scenery.
The
magic dances and the charming songs.
And
but wait a minute. Something's wrong.
We're going to pull this dough apart. Are you ready?
Mambo Italiano, hey, hey, Mambo. Mambo Italiano, go, go, go. Pick up a Siciliano, all you Calabrese, do the mambo like a crazy with the hey, Mambo. Don't wanna tarantella, hey, hey, Mambo. No more mozzarella, hey, Mambo. Mambo Italiano, try an
angelo.
Bacalanda, hey, Roomba. I love how you dance to Roomba. But take some advice by someone. Learn how to mambo. If you're gonna be a square, you ain't gonna go away. Hey, Mambo. Mambo Italiano. Hey, Mambo. Mambo Italiano. Go, go, Joe. Take it like a Giovanna. Hello, kiss it.
You guys have done
happy
this
in the pizza when you mambo. Italiano. Hey, Juggalos, you don't have to go to the school. Choose to make it with a pizza bambino. It's like a bean. Kid, you can look, but you don't know what to cook and do. Hey, Mambo. Mambo Italiano, hey, Mambo. Mambo Italiano, ho, ho, ho. You mixed up a Siciliano. Hello, kissy, did you get happy in the
people
when you mambo Italiano?
Take a bite. Excellent, excellent.
Fantastic.
So, that's just a very, very quick idea of how fun it is to dance. Did you feel like you were exercising? No, but you were. We were stretching. We were working our muscle strength. We worked our endurance, our cardio, our expression. So please visit dancingwithparkinsons.com. Sign up for free and join us on the dance floor every morning at 11.
Wow, fantastic, Sarah. Thanks so much. I think we all have joined together to say thank you. That was wonderful for a midday break. And now we're welcome Priti Gros to tell us a little bit about the research that she's done through the Dancing with Parkinson's program.
So thank you very much, Ruth. So thank you again for the opportunity to talk about our research project. So I'm very thrilled to be here. So the title of our talk today is Studying Dance in Parkinson's Disease Using Wearable Device. And so that was a research project I've been doing in the past year under the supervision of Dr. Kalia, who's here as well. So I have no disclosures. So first, I want to tell you a bit about the background and why we're doing this project. So as you guys know, Parkinson's disease affects quality of life. And some of the challenges we have as clinicians that are hard to address are things like stigma, isolation, and emotional well-being. And that's partly why there has been an increasing interest for complementary therapies for Parkinson's disease. And one of them is dance. And among six systematic reviews that look at dance in PD, so those are large studies that review all the other smaller studies in the literature, so four of them suggest that dance could be better than other exercise intervention for PD. But the problem with most of the studies is that they don't use objective measures. And so because of that, it's difficult to derive very firm conclusions from that. And so that's where we're filling the gap. And the research question we're asking is whether it's doable to have people with Parkinson's disease dance as part of a study, but also using wearable devices. So those look like Apple Watch, and they allow us to capture activity, dance, and sleep in an objective way. And so that's what we've been trying to do in the past year. So we've designed what we call a pilot study, which means a smaller study that basically ask whether it's doable to recruit people with Parkinson's disease, have them dance, and wear the devices, and check if that's actually safe and tolerable, and whether it's feasible to capture activity, dance, and sleep, eventually to design a bigger study called a randomized controlled trial that will eventually be asking the question whether dance and usual care is superior to stretching, exercise, and usual care to improve quality of life and help motor and non-motor features of Parkinson's disease. And that will be using wearable device. So for the purpose of our study, we've been focusing on that smaller study. And so what we've been doing, we've been recruiting people with Parkinson's disease from the movement disorder clinic and from the Dance with Parkinson classes. And we basically included people that were able to understand English and were willing to be part of the dance class for 3 months, but they had to have a diagnosis of Parkinson's disease. And we excluded anyone that had an allergy to the material used for the sensors, any medical condition that precludes sensing, or if they were unable to consent. And so our intervention was the Dance with Parkinson classes. Then we're very lucky to work with Sarah Robichaud and the Dance with Parkinson Canada group. And what's really beautiful is that we're able to have anyone, so people that were walking independently to people in wheelchair, because the classes allow for that. So we were very grateful. And we've been using those wearable devices that you see here on the left from the Genactive company. And we've been putting two on each wrist. So one on each wrist and one on each ankle on our participants. And what we've been doing is that we've been doing two sets of data collection. So for the first part, people were having the sensor for 7 days in a row, 24/7, where we're capturing activity, sleep, and then they were returning the sensors back to us. Then they were dancing for 3 months. And then after that, we're repeating the same data collection 3 months later and try to see if there is any difference before and after dancing. And we're very lucky to be working with the ONDRI team, who has helped us design the study and also has helped us analyzing these sensors. And I just want to show you a few results we've had. So because of time, I'm going to show just a small part. But this is what we've got. So we contacted 21 participants, and among the 21, 14 agreed to be part of the study, and 9 were able to complete the first part of the data collection. That was before the 3 months of dance. And 6 were able to complete both part 1 and part 2. So for 6 people, we have 2 sets of data collection. But unfortunately, we had to stop the data collection because of COVID and the fact that we had to self-isolate. But that still gave us a good recruitment rate and retention rate that'll be satisfactory for the larger study we want to do in the future. And we looked at safety. And so a small number of people had falls during the 7 days of data collection. So 2 people had a fall in the first part of the data collection, and 2 people had a fall after. But none of those falls were related to either the dance class or wearing the sensors. And all the participants except 1 had a history of multiple falls before coming to the study. So that's something we recorded. Now we asked our participants what they thought about the sensors, and the large majority actually had a positive experience with the sensors, mainly because they were simple to use and they were discreet. Some people reported minor inconveniences, including the fact that sometimes they can be a bit harder to put on, or they're a bit bulky, or that they can sometimes fall off. But yet we realized that despite those minor inconveniences, people were willing and able to wear the sensors more than 80% of the time. So that was quite reassuring and tells us that it's still tolerable. That's an example of the type of the activity that we can capture with the sensors. So here I'm showing the daily average step counts for the 6, so that's 5 actually, but we have 5 individuals that were able to have a full study. So what you see in blue is the data collection that was done before the 3 months of dancing, And what you see in gray is the data collection that was done after. And any sets, all the sets of bar represent one individual. So here we have five person. And we can see that three out of the five people had a better, so an increased average step counts when we were comparing before and after. So that was quite encouraging. And one of the other things we're capturing is quality of life. So for that, we're using questionnaire. And here we see that there was a trend for a better quality of life when we're comparing before and after 3 months of dancing. So again, that was quite encouraging. And so our conclusion was that it was doable to enroll participants to the dance study. It was feasible and safe. The wearable devices were tolerable, and we were able to capture objective measures of activity in Parkinson's disease. Here, I'm not showing the sleep data, but that's something else we were able to do. And we're also noticing that dance appears to influence positively quality of life. And I think all of us had an idea of that a few minutes ago. And so we also concluded it's possible and feasible to proceed with the larger study, so the randomized control trial. So I want to acknowledge a few people, but most specifically Dr. Kalia, who is my main supervisor on that project, and Sarah Robichaud, of course, who has provided great dance classes. And I want to thank our resilient and enthusiastic dancer with Parkinson. And I also want to mention that, as Sarah said, please attend those classes. They're great. I've attended them myself. So I want to ask if there's any question.
Thank you so much, Priti. So why don't we see if anyone wants to unmute themselves and ask questions. We've certainly got some questions through the chat group. So we could start with those, or we can, as I said in the note, we can go a little later than two and answer some questions if ever anyone's interested. But as you start to unmute yourself, why don't I wrote down some questions. So the first question talked about COVID and potential increases or impacts on Parkinson's disease. Perhaps Mario, you can address that.
Okay, there, someone, I was forced into mute. Hold on a second. Sorry, I was just, what was the first question there, Ruth, again? Oh, COVID-19.
COVID-19 and potential impacts.
This is an interesting question. I'd also be interested to hear Dr. Kalia's opinion as well. I don't think there's been any evidence that, you know, COVID-19 increases your risk for Parkinson's disease. I know that there's been a lot of talk and concern about COVID-19. There is some interesting association. So first of all, some people, not all people who have COVID-19, can develop the loss of sense of smell. That's called anosmia. And so, and there have been some neuropathological studies of people with severe COVID who passed away to show that the COVID was present in the olfactory tracts. That's the kind of parts of the brain that can perceive smell. So it's not clear whether or not there would be any kind of association between having COVID that infiltrated into the olfactory bulbs and if that can set the stage for changes, because the olfactory tracts and bulbs can also be affected in Parkinson's disease, and that's why they lose the sense of smell. But right now, there is really no evidence. I don't know if Lorraine has anything else to comment on that.
Yeah, I'd say there is no definitive evidence. There's a lot of hypothesis, and probably many of you are reading, and where this question came from was a lot of speculation. As Mario mentioned, neuropathological studies to date haven't shown actual Parkinson's disease developing in the context of COVID, although people who have passed away having Parkinson's disease were found on pathology to have Parkinson's disease as expected, because in life they had Parkinson's disease. And I think where the hypothesis comes from, and this is, you're just gonna have to keep an eye on that space to see what happens from a research point of view, is that there's, as probably most of you know, whenever you ask somebody, why did I get Parkinson's disease? We don't have an answer, because we don't actually know what causes Parkinson's disease. And for a long time, one of the thoughts was maybe there was an exposure that people have had to some kind of infectious agent. So that still exists, that maybe there's some infectious agent that could lead to Parkinson's. And I think most of us believe that's probably also in the context of inflammation. And so there's a lot of talk about inflammation and this kind of, you know, inflammatory storm that people get with COVID. And so I think we'll have to, we don't have a definitive answer at all, but I think we're going to keep our mind open and time will tell.
Thank you. I wonder if either of you can comment on, there's a couple of drug questions. One is about Serotia, I don't know if I'm pronouncing it right, and Nerva that are being used in the Philippines. And also another comment about there being no new relevant medications in the past 50 years for Parkinson's. So.
Yeah, I was scanning the questions. So every country has a different name for the drugs, and the Serotia and Nerva are actually quetiapine and clozapine. So these are what we call atypical antipsychotics that are used to treat psychosis and behaviors associated with Parkinson's disease. So many Parkinson's patients, especially when they as the disease progresses, they can also develop behavioral changes and neuropsychiatric symptoms, and visual hallucinations are particularly prominent, but they can also develop delusions. And so these drugs can be used to treat those symptoms of the disease along with other drugs if there is cognitive impairment or dementia associated with the presence of this. Other drugs such as cholinesterase inhibitors, these are drugs that are used for Alzheimer's dementia and Parkinson's dementia. They can also significantly improve the hallucinations as well. Antipsychotic drugs, though, other than quetiapine and clozapine, any other type of antipsychotic drug that I'm talking about, ones available in Canada, because there's another one in the US that we don't have available, these drugs can worsen Parkinson's disease. So that's why I immediately looked it up, because I wanted to make sure they weren't what we call typical antipsychotic drugs, which can also produce very catastrophic reactions. So if someone with Parkinson's disease, as a teaching point for people on the call, if someone develops psychosis or hallucinations in Parkinson's disease, be very cautious about being prescribed any antipsychotics other than clozapine or quetiapine.
And can you comment maybe on some new research that you know of that's ongoing for new drugs or new you know, brand new molecules, et cetera?
Yeah, so there's lots of different clinical trials that are looking at what we call disease-modifying therapies. And this is considered the holy grail in neurodegenerative disease because, as you know, we do not have any drugs that can modify the disease course. We have drugs that can treat the symptoms. And in Parkinson's disease, levodopa for a number of years can help, can help quite a bit. But ultimately, the responses start to wear off and you start to get on-off motor complications. So these are all things that still drug trials going on for symptomatic therapies as well in Parkinson's disease. And I think one question pertains to whether or not we would be doing any studies using the Watson-based drugs. We could, we haven't, this will come down the road. We would have to start with kind of smaller clinical trials, but I also think it's very important that we understand more about the basic science mechanisms of these drugs that have been identified through Watson. And so Dr. Kalia's lab is specializing in models, different kinds of models where they can look in either animals or what we call brain organoid models. And to be able to kind of look at effects of this. I don't know if Dr. Kalia had any other comments on that. I think she might have had to leave.
Yeah, no, I'm still here.
Oh, there you are. Sorry, I didn't see you.
Yeah, it's okay. I guess just to comment on what's going on. I mean, I think there's a fair number. We could talk about the Watson hits kind of separate, I guess, and we are still looking at those in the laboratory. But in terms of what's kind of in humans right now from a clinical trials point of view, there are definitely ongoing trials. And I'm sure Parkinson's Canada posts that on their website. And of course, Michael J. Fox Foundation has a lot of information with that as well. And a lot of strategies to try and target that protein alpha-synuclein that Dr. Masellis mentioned in his this talk are actually now in clinical trials. So small molecules are about to be tested, antibodies are being tested. And then coming down the pipeline, I think also are forms of treatment that are going to be targeted specifically for people with genetic types of Parkinson's disease. Those I think are really kind of at the forefront right now. So those are probably the trials that you're going to start hearing about.
Yeah. And there was another question about, are we recruiting people with young onset Parkinson's disease? In our initial phase of ONDRI, we were interested in looking at later onset disease. And so most of our patients in our first cohort were over the age of 65. But I think we will be interested in other forms of Parkinson's disease. In terms of young onset disease, depending on what age you develop it at, you might consider, and if there, especially in the wake of there being a family history, there should be some consideration to do genetic testing. But generally speaking, when we talk about young onset, under the age of 40, and if there's a family history, then it ups the ante for looking for genes. And so this may open you up for other specific trials that are targeting particular mutations. There are mutations in the most common ones being GBA, glucocerebrosidase gene, as well as the LRRK2, that are some major targets, but there's some rarer forms as well that could also be targeted eventually. And so there's trials going on with that.
Terrific. So in the spirit of not trying to keep people too late, why don't we answer one of these questions on the dancing with Parkinson's? And then we've got a member of our PCAC who wanted to just say a couple words, so Larry Linton. But first, Sarah, what's involved in training dance instructors to provide dancing with Parkinson's, and are instructors still available? Is the training still available during COVID?
Yes, it is actually. We just had a call about that a couple of days ago. So every year, David Leventhal from Dance for PD in New York, Dance for PD is actually the organization that started the very first Dancing with for Parkinson's class about, I think, 16, 17 years ago. So I learned from them. We are now all partners. So Dance for PD, Parkinson Canada, the National Ballet School, and Dancing with Parkinson's, we're all part of the Dance for Parkinson's Network Canada. And one of the things that we do is we want to obviously share in the same goal of having as many people with Parkinson's across Canada to be able to access these classes. And by having many, many classes across Canada, we need many, many trained, highly skilled teachers, because this method is very specific. And so once a year, David Leventhal usually comes from New York City, and he and I co-lead a few days of teacher training at the National Ballet School for people from all across Canada to come and partake in. And we just discussed that we are still going to go ahead with the training, and it's going to be some kind of hybrid model. So there will be some in person and then some online, and most likely, depending when we do it, David will be zooming in from New York City. But again, if you want to contact me at sarah@dancingwithparkinsons.com, Lisa, I would be happy to tell you all about the plans.
Perfect, perfect. And similarly, as I said in written form, if there are questions that we missed today, we really do apologize, and please email them to us at info@ondri.ca, and we'll make sure we get you an answer. But finally, as I said, one of our PCAC members, Larry Linton, who lives with Parkinson's disease, wanted to say a couple of words. So I'll hand it over to Larry.
Oh, thank you. I just wanted to say to Sarah that I'd love to come out and do the dancing, as long as I can wear my white polyester suit and platform shoes and go back to the disco days.
We do disco every time, and I would expect you to wear that outfit. So yes.
and I'd love to bring my drums with. So my sort of comment is whether or not I can approach you offline to talk about music with Parkinson's, because I play the drums, and I found that the physicality of drumming has helped me tremendously with my motor symptoms. But so I congratulate you on this initiative. I think it's great. And just from the wearables, from my perspective, I mean, I'm fortunate enough that I have got and still participate in a strenuous exercise regime. So I'm very excited about this wearable technology, because I think that's going to be the way of the future. I mean, I've got my, you know, my Fitbit right here, and I'd love this to be expanded so that, you know, Dr. Masellis and other specialists can see us in our environment. I think it's very important. And I look forward to participating wherever I can in that technology. So thanks for the opportunity.
Terrific. Thank you, Larry. And we will be recruiting for some of these studies that are some of the hands-on Ontario studies that Dr. Masellis was talking about. So watch out. You know, obviously, Larry, you'll have an insider view on that being in our PCAC, but everybody else, certainly watch out for on our website, et cetera. We will be recruiting for new studies as we go. So that with that, I wanted to just say thank you so much for all our wonderful speakers for speaking, and all our wonderful guests for listening to what we had to say, and for Parkinson's Canada, of course, for co-hosting the session with us. And we look forward to being in touch with you again. Look out for, as I said, our website, and look for any updates from us. Okay, so thanks so much.
Thanks, everyone.
Thanks, ONDRI team and all the panelists. This was great.
Terrific, thank you.